everybody feels the same. Why's nobody talking?
My name is Meredith. I'm a director at a firm called Darkwave Consulting. We are business consultants and accountants for the arts and entertainment industry. We are sitting in my meeting room in our offices in Fitzroy. Things that I personally like, or for people that know me, I wear a lot of black and have for a very long time. My music's a little bit diversified. I like everything. I grew up in the 80s, so a lot of it is based still back then. I'm still very big on The Cure. I still like bands like Nine Inch Nails and Pet Shop Boys and Daft Punk. But then newer artists, I love hearing stuff from newer artists as well. I love film in general. I will go and see any film. The thing, of course, I like the most, me personally, is my two kids. I see artists struggling with generally just managing their money. A lot of them don't have much guidance into how to make their profession into an actual business and a viable business and a business that will continue for years to come. There seems to be quite a big gap in how they can go about from just commencing their business to actually making it a profitable business going forward. If an artist wants to make a long-term career from their business, they need to first consider themselves to be in business and not consider themselves as a hobbyist, and that's one of the biggest obstacles to overcome to begin with. It's nothing really to do with how much money they're making that makes it transition from hobby to business. A lot of it is about their intentions. It's about putting procedures in place. If they need to spend money on advertising and promotion and building their brand, then that's something that they might need to do depending on what avenue their business is. It might be different for some people that are artists in the way that they might be painters or work in art installation versus some people that are musicians or filmmakers. Networking is a great way to meet people and like-minded people in your own industry that can certainly give each other a helping hand along the way. And there's a lot of people in the industry that are very approachable and are happy to give advice on how they started and how they transitioned from it to being a small business to being a successful business. If you are starting an arts business and you want to, the basics of what you need to do for that business in Australia are, firstly, you need a Australian business number, which you can do online through the Australian Business Register. Secondly, if you do not want to trade under your own name, you will need to register a business name. You register with ASIC, and you can either register for 1 or 3 years. After you've done those two things, the next thing will be to work out like your invoice templates, how you're going to bill people, the terms and conditions of how you bill those people, and also work out your expenses. After you have set up your ABN and hopefully your business name, it's advisable to set up a business bank account, and that is generally useful so that all the income from the business goes into that one account, and then you're trying to expend all of your business expenses out of that account, and it's just to keep all your business expenses separate from your private expenses so that you're not mixing them up, and that will give you in the early stages an indication of how your business is going without having to, you know, basically be able to read accounting reports and things like that. It'll give you a snapshot of just how cash-wise you are going. One of the best things to do is to just have a research on any grants that are available in your area. There's normally a lot of federal, state, and even some council grants that are available. It's generally a good idea to know what those are early on, and if you want to apply for them, to do it well in advance of when the deadline is, just so that you can be as organised as possible. And then after all of that, then there's tax. When you're starting your own business, one of the best things now to do for invoicing is to use one of the invoicing apps like FreshBooks, There's zero if you're running a slightly bigger business, but they're all online, they're all via the cloud. It's easy for you to keep track of how you're invoicing, who owes you what at any given point in time. Once you've got that, then it's really a matter of putting all your expenses together. It's best to talk to a tax advisor on what you can actually claim against your business. It's different for everyone. So there's not a one rule fits all. And yeah, it will generally depend on your individual circumstances as to what you can claim and what information you need to retain for tax purposes. Once you register your ABN, you have the option to either register for GST. You don't have to register for GST if your turnover is going to be below $75,000. Some people still can voluntarily register for GST if they're under that. If you are under, you can register for GST annually, which means that you just do one business activity statement at the same time as you do your income tax return. If you are over the $75,000 threshold from your business activity, then you do need to lodge quarterly BASs with the ATO. If you are self-employed, you do not need to pay yourself super. However, if you employ anybody, you will need to pay those people super, depending on what type of arrangement you have with them. Currently, the super rate is 9.25% of their gross wage. When you run your own business, if you are running as a sole trader, you can't technically pay yourself a wage as such, but it's a good idea to get into the habit of making sure that you have enough income to cover your personal living expenses. Normally, what a lot of people do is they'll set the target quite low to start with. They might try and transfer $250 a week or $500 a week from their business account to their personal account. And that will, in their mind, just help them to separate business versus personal and realise that they are actually working for themselves. When I first started my career, the firm that I first worked for specialised in music, so basically was able to communicate, hopefully, to them in a way that they would understand. One of the biggest issues that artists tend to have with business professionals and also lawyers as well is that there seems to be a communication barrier on how you can explain quite strict tax and business legislation to someone that is creative. So you need to describe it in a way where they might understand. I've been working as an accountant now for 16 years, and in that time I could say it is definitely possible in a variety of art forms to make a living in Australia, whether you're an artist or a musician or an actor or a filmmaker. You can absolutely make a living as a creative person in Australia. You don't necessarily need international success to make a living. You need to be quite proactive. You need to keep going, even if you're an artist and you've had a gallery exhibition that didn't go well, or you're a musician whose last CD wasn't received particularly well. It's just really about moving forward and almost putting that behind you, and you've just got to keep on going and don't be so, it's hard to say, but try and not be so sensitive about what other people have said about your past products. And if you don't get, say, Album of the Week on Triple J, that is not the end of the world. You can still keep going and you might have a fantastic run on an album the next one you do. For artists to not only run their business long term, but to have money for themselves at the age where they may want to retire, there's a few things that they may need to consider. One would be that they can either have voluntarily put money into super during their career span. Sometimes that's not always possible depending on what their cash flow has been like. There has always been a little bit of an issue with insurance in that a lot of insurers won't tend to insure artists for income protection, but certainly trying to put some money into super is a good idea. Or if you can't do that, trying to invest or save enough money to buy a house, even if it's somewhere out in the country somewhere, or it doesn't have to be in a city, Melbourne, just somewhere where you can slowly build a nest egg by owning your own property. When people do succeed, and a lot of them, it's been a long time coming, so you'll find that with a lot of them, they may have been working at their particular profession for 10 to 20 years before they really do see that financial success. A lot of them will have critical success quite early on, but that doesn't necessarily translate to financial success in arts-related industries. So what when they do reach that point where they actually are financially successful, generally most of them, the first thing they do is they'll pay out all their credit cards and loans. Normally they'll try and buy a house for themselves. Some of them will pay their family back. If that's been the case, sometimes it is. A lot of them will put money into creative projects where they then mentor and help younger artists coming up and start non-for-profit organisations. If it's in a particular industry that they are passionate about. And a lot of it, though, goes back into developing more art, more music, developing new projects. Artists in general, and I know a couple of thousand of them, they generally are probably the nicest people that I've met. They're very generous. They generally have really high morals. They're kind to other people. Art itself has an enormous impact on society. People that aren't in any arts field, they can still remember, you know, the song that everyone was playing at the year at camp, or the movie that they saw with their first partner or boyfriend or girlfriend, or they'll see some sort of art's really there to inspire people. It's there to inspire other artists. It's there to inspire people in general. Reality check on money is that, unfortunately, everyone needs it to survive. You can't live in this society without having money. It's quite difficult. There is nothing wrong with artists having success and being able to show that they're successful, and to be financially successful, you should never, ever be ashamed of that. Being a working family and having two young kids, it's not easy. You need to be really organised. It's certainly doable. You certainly realise what your priorities are very early on, and ultimately family does come first. And sometimes there is an issue trying to convey that across to clients, that you can't actually be on call 24/7 because you do have other outside commitments that you do need to deal with. But it's a juggle, but it's enjoyable, and yeah, I'd recommend it.